إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. There was a British officer in the India British Army at the time when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab رحمه الله started his mission, or just towards the end of the first Saudi state, who wanted to meet Ibrahim Pasha to thank him on his victory over the followers of Ibn Abdul Wahhab. He wanted to meet Ibrahim Pasha to thank him for his role in destroying the followers of Muhammad Ibn Abdul Wahhab, as they thought. So there was a British spy who went to Arabia to further the goals and the benefit for the British Empire that hired him. Ibrahim Pasha is the adopted son of Muhammad Ali Pasha, who was a ruler of Egypt, famous warrior from Macedonia originally, who became the ruler of Egypt on behalf of the Uthmani Khilafah. Inshallah, we'll talk a little bit more about that. But let's talk about the trip that Sadler took, which was a part of the plot against the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab in Arabia. The trip to Arabia taken by the British officer Sadler of the 47th Regiment as the emissary of the British India government in the company of a large caravan made up mostly of Turks. So let's understand quickly what's going on. British officer taking a trip to Arabia under protection of a large caravan made up mostly of Turks. That trip exposed a significant part of a conspiracy to destroy the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, which became a unifying symbol of Muslim awakening during that time. Sadler took a difficult trip from India to Riyadh, then to the ruins of Dar'iyya, which was the capital of the first Islamic, of the first Saudi state, which was razed to the ground by Ibrahim Pasha. According to a plot that involved British participation, Sadler wanted to personally inspect the dismantling of the Islamic State, which was established in Arabia, and so aroused Muslim awareness. He wanted to see for himself the destruction of the Salafi da'wah that caused anxiety and concern to the British government, which was fearful for its interests, especially in India. Sadler's trip also exposed British hatred towards Islam, because he gave thanks and commended Ibrahim Pasha for the destruction of what they called the Wahhabi. Now, the first person, it seems, to use the term Wahhabi to describe the movement of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was this British officer. Let's read a little bit more about him, and then inshallah go on with the lecture. That officer was to proceed to Qatif or Uqayr on the Hasa coast, the Ahsa, and from there make his way inland to Dar'iyya, when Ibrahim Pasha's camp was believed to be located, but we didn't find him there, they had already moved. His instructions were, during your residence in the Turkish camp, you will endeavor to ascertain with as much delicacy as possible the nature of Ibrahim Pasha's views in the future prosecution of his conquest in the Arabian shores of the Persian Gulf. So that was a dual mission. He was a spy for the British Empire, was happy for the destruction of the Saudi state, wanted to go congratulate that Ibrahim Pasha, at the same time to spy on him and see what he wants to do for, you know, in the future with regards to Arabia. Having learned today, and there is no historical evidence to prove that anyone before him actually used the term Wahhabi, it is amazing to see Muslims these days use this term as if it is a truth or reality. Now, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, his first name is Muhammad. Had he started a new sect, it is acceptable maybe that to call that sect Muhammadi sect. But you know, if somebody was called Muhammadi in somehow, people would connect him to who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they thought, let's distance ourselves from that name. They used the word Wahhabi. That's not his first name. That's his father's Abd al-Wahhab name. And instead of saying, for example, Abdis, because Muhammadi doesn't work, Abdis, they said Wahhabis. Who's al-Wahhab? Allah. So they ran away from calling that sect, according to them, to the people, and instead they called it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was a gift from Allah. Al-Wahhab means someone who gives in abundance. And it was a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regardless. But that name doesn't have any reality in it. You have to understand, brothers and sisters, that when Muhammad ibn al-Wahhab came, this was the status of Arabia during that time. We'll talk about it. But first, I want you to remember some dates. They're very important, inshallah, for our lecture tonight. And they are about the birth and death of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. According to Ibn Ghannam, who's a contemporary historian and follower of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, and other reliable sources, Ibn Abdul Wahhab was born in the year 1115 after the Hijrah, which is 1703 Miladi in the Gregorian calendar, in the city of Uyayna, and died in 1206 Hijriya, 1792 in the Gregorian calendar. So, 1703 to 1792. Let's talk about the status of Islam in Najd, which is in central center of the Arabian Peninsula, just before Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab started his movement. Many scholars of history report to us that the Arab during that time reverted to their old status of Jahiliyyah before Islam to a large extent. Now the graves again became the focus of worship, where people would go around graves like they do around the Kaaba, invoke the dead for help, and commit the very shirk that Allah sent his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam to destroy. Not only that, also the Arab during that time revered trees, stones, and sought barakah, blessing from them, and decisions in their matter. It is shameful, but I have to say it so that you can understand the mentality of the Arab in the Arab Peninsula during that time. Some women, when they didn't have children and they wanted to have children, they would go to a tree in their area that's known to them, and she would be told that, have sex with a branch of that tree so you can have a child later on. This is documented. This is documented. It's not like a joke. It's documented, and it is among people who used to say La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. The problem that we see that many Muslims today, they don't think about it too much. La ilaha illallah has requirements. Among them, you only worship Allah alone without partners. So if somebody revealed the dead who couldn't help themselves, they're dead, they can't help themselves, how can they help anyone? If they could help anyone, they would have helped themselves and by staying alive. They're dead. People go around the grave, invoke the dead. And Salah, forget about it. A large segment of people didn't even pray, including in Mecca, where they see the Kaaba, but still, and they hear the Adhan, but still they don't make Salah. Zakah almost never existed at that time. Khalas, people from a long time before, they stopped giving Zakah. The other aspects of Islam in Arabia was very violent. Again, divided into many tribes and sub-tribes and local areas ruled by people who are called Amir. And these people will fight with each other. And violence was to such an extent that during that time, if somebody from other areas wanted to go to Hajj, they would leave a will and say, because they expect, for the most part, not to come back alive. was many of them were killed and robbed on the way. So this is the status of Arabia when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab started learning the Sunnah by going to the scholars of Sunnah who were not many during that time, but learning from them the Sunnah and tradition of the Aqidah, of the Islamic Aqidah, and then going to Mecca and Medina trips and to Basra. Never went to Baghdad, it seems. There is no evidence to that. Never went to the Damascus or Sham area, or to Egypt, as some people reported. Then went back to Huraymila, which was the town where his father died. And it was, inshallah ta'ala, we'll talk about that. It's very important about when his father died, because he went back to that town, which is in Najd, which is today in the eastern part of Arabia, northeast. That Najd part where Riyadh today exists. He went back to that area from Basra after his father died. Now, the scholars who reported the status of Islam in Arabia during that time mentioned, for example, the gravesite of Zayd ibn al-Khattab, who was the brother of Umar ibn al-Khattab, in Jubayla, a town near Uyayna. Uyayna is also significant because Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab tried to seek help from the ruler of Uyayna for the da'wah, to quote the call to the Quran and Sunnah, but he rejected it and almost had him killed. But people used to go, pilgrims used to humbly invoke Zayd, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with him, because he was one of the Sahaba, to fulfill their needs. Zayd is a brother of Umar, and I would doubt it very, very much that they would accept a hint of even this to happen to them, having been the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Dir'iyya, there was a gravesite belonging to one of the Sahaba. It wasn't named. And then also, there were revealed caves, each with a mystical story behind it. In the town of Manfuha, there were male date trees that became the center of superstitious practices. And I mentioned this about the unwed women or other, you know, women who wanted to have children or a husband. Of course, that's not the place you go to find a husband. You find only, you know, birds and trees, and definitely the shayateen. Because people who revert to these ideas, they don't, you know, invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they didn't take from the resource, which was the resource of the Sahaba and the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is tawheed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone gives, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone takes. Quraysh, during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he was sent as their prophet and messenger, had the same problem with, you know, the stones and the idols. They didn't actually think that the idols created them, but they thought that they can give them help and support. They would say, we're not pure. We can't invoke Allah directly. We have to have an intermediary between us and Allah, so that we can, you know, convey to them our needs and they can convey to Allah our needs, because they believed Allah created them. They believe, just like the people in Arabia during the time of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, that Allah created them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَلَئِن سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهِ. If you ask them, meaning, oh Muhammad, ask your people, if you ask them, who created the heavens and earth, they would say, Allah. Therefore, they didn't deny that Allah is the creator. However, they took these things and idols and stones and trees as intermediaries between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to an extent of, you know, it's really funny even to record this story, but this is what they used to do during the time or before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent. Some of them, because they want to travel, and they think that valleys and hills would have jinn of their own, and they can harm them. So for protection, if they went to a valley, usually they would say, I seek refuge with the master of this valley. And when the jinn heard that, they thought that they're invoking them. We don't want you to bother us. They would actually bother them badly and cause them to become even mad because of the touching of the jinn of these people. So some of them said, we'll take the gods with us also. They couldn't carry a stone on a donkey, because the donkey will revolt. It's too heavy. So what they did, they made idols out of dates, because now it's heavy. It's not heavy, as heavy as a stone. And he has the god, now the shape of the god that he worshipped. False god, of course. And they take the trip. When they got hungry, they ate their god. That they ate the date. And then, of course, continued the journey without protection of these idols. When you hear this about the people before Islam, you would think, it's natural, it's jahiliya, this is shirk, this is what they earned and learned from the generations that came before that. But the grave sites that were spread all over, like for example in Hijaz, the Prophet ﷺ and his companions and family members were the center of worship. What did Rasulullah ﷺ say towards the end of his life? لَعْنَ اللَّهُ الْيَهُودَ وَالنَّصَارَى اتَّخَذُوا قُبُورَ أَنْبِيَائِهِمْ مَسَاجِدٍ. May Allah curse the Jews and the Christians who turned the grave sites of their prophets into places of worship. Aisha said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, boys, no noise please. Don't talk. Please, we're giving a lecture. You don't like it, you can go out. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, may Allah curse the Jews and Christians for turning the grave sites of their prophets into places of worship. Aisha said, he said that to warn his nation, his ummah, against doing that. It is as if he said to them, turn the grave sites of your prophets into places of worship, because that's many of them what they did later on. And to talk about the Sham area or Egypt during that time, it would be even more and far worse than what I had described. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he grew in that environment, and then started learning from the scholars of Sunnah about the correct, authentic creed and how to practice the Sunnah, and then looked at the status of the Ummah, and he was horrified that the Ummah of Muhammad, the Ummah of Tawheed, the Ummah of La Ilaha Illallah, would turn into such, you know, laws of shirk, clear shirk, injustice, and abandoning the aspects of Islam that are the major aspects of the religion, from Salah, Siyam, and Zakah. Hajj was a ceremony that was kept, but like I said, it wasn't even safe to go there. The rulers who wanted to even travel for Hajj, they would take a large army detachment so they can protect themselves on the way. So he looked at the Ummah and said, this is not what Allah sent Rasul for. So he goes to Uyayna after he finished the trips to learn from Mecca to Medina to Basra at the end. He goes back to Uyayna years before his father died. And he died 1147, his father. He came back to Uyayna, that city that where his father resided, Huraymila first and then Uyayna. His father died years before that. Then he wanted to start his mission to call people to Tawheed, and to call people to Tawheed, back to the correct Aqeedah, to the correct faith in Allah and His names and attributes. Among the names of Allah is that He's Al-Razzaq, the one who gives the sustenance. And therefore, how can you call a stone or a bottle or a tree or another person for rizq when it is Allah who has it? So he wanted them to go back to Tawheed in its pure form, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the companions and the generations that came after that, you know, came with Tawheed, asserted Tawheed, believed in it, and established it on earth. So this was the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab in summary. Therefore, it is strange that some Muslims would say that when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was in Basra, he met a British consul or agent and agreed on a secret mission for Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab to do in Arabia. I could imagine, I mean, what kind of conversation went on. The British Council would be saying to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, we are horrified at the shirk that the Ummah of Muhammad fell into. And they are divided, they are weak, they do shirk, they don't pray, they don't fast. We would like you, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, to go establish Tawheed, unite them again around Tawheed, and called him to the Quran and Sunnah and Salah and Siyam and Zakah. And you say, okay. And the payment is nothing, because you got nothing out of that. Of course, it didn't happen. Now remember, he was born 1115. He died. This is Hijriya. Let's go back to the date. He died 1206 Hijriya. He was born 1703, and he died 1792. And therefore, when we talk about him being in the Basra region, and we said that historically it was proved that he went back to his town before his father died, which is in 1147. Now let's talk about some British man here reported something about Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, and we said here authentic historical reports said that Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, Sheikh Abdul Wahhab, the father of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, died in 1153-1740. I said 1747, 1740 actually. And Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab went back to that town of his birth, which is Huraymila, years before his father died. And never went back to Basra again. Remember, Najd is where Riyadh is today, it's in Arabia. Basra is in the southern part of Iraq. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab left it 1740, and we should mention a few things here written by Orientalists. They say that during that time, the British involvement in the Arabian Gulf was minimal. It was about protecting their commercial routes from there to Britain and Europe. They didn't have much of a military presence in the Gulf area. And also, the policy of Britain was mainly concentrated about protecting their interests. Nothing to be thought of like interference or anything like that. Now, when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab went back to Huraymila and then to Uyayna after his father died, it was 1740. The first British consulate was recognized in Basra in 1767. How many years after he left? Do you study math, brothers? From 1740 to 1767. How many years? 27 years the British came after he left. How did they meet? Where? We can rule out the internet, faxes, phones. No, how did they meet? During that time, actually, he was engaged very busy with the da'wah when he started in the Najd area. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab then never met anyone in Basra. And knowing the British and French and Americans, you know, they're all the same. They're not going to meet somebody and tell him, you have to bring back Tawheed. So that, you know, because we hate the fact that the Arab are divided and weak and, you know, they don't pray. Then he would say, okay, I'll do that. And then it doesn't make any sense, does it? If you remember the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, which is to bring back Tawheed to the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Among the things that we need to talk about today is the fact that we have a question here. Why was Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab the target until today of these vicious attacks on him, rahimahullah? He didn't bring in a new religion, he just went back to Quran and Sunnah. His Tawheed, if you read it in Arabic or in English, you will find that all what's in there is the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and remembering Tawheed as it should be remembered, that Allah is the Rabb, the creator, sustainer of everything. That Allah has the most beautiful names and perfect attributes, and that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that whole book is about three aspects which are the foundation of our Tawheed. Allah is the Rabb, Allah has the most beautiful names and perfect attributes, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one to be worshipped. Also, he emphasized the role of the Sunnah, that we must follow the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That was his mission. And if you look at it, what's the difference between that and what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with? The Sahaba, the Tabi'een, the Imams of Islam. What did Ibn Taymiyyah do during his time that was different from what Ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did? Of course, Ibn Taymiyyah, you know, these days, many people will come and say, Ibn Taymiyyah this, Ibn Taymiyyah that. I once was talking to a person in America. We were disputing, like every year, mashallah, the Ummah of Muhammad. I don't know what happens here. I hope it doesn't here, but it doesn't happen here. But in America, this we have problem every Ramadan. They fight about which day to start the fast, which day to end it. Shawwal, they don't fight. Rabi', they don't fight. Jumada, they don't. It's just when Ramadan comes, Shaitan, it seems, descends on some of them so they can dispute about it. So they told me, come, you know, let's, you know, talk about it. I didn't know they were preparing their books and maps and everything to convince me that we should follow calculations. I came there and sat, and the guy came with huge maps. I said, you know, before you even start with these maps, let me tell you, brother, don't be arrogant. Don't think I'm a Palestinian with this beard that I didn't study. I definitely studied more than you'd think, especially about astronomy. And I can speak English, alhamdulillah, to a good extent, and Arabic. Therefore, sit down and calm down. Let's talk about it, you know. Why do you want to use a map? This and that, you know, calculation. I said, listen, I'm asking you a question. Is sighting the moon for the new lunar month, is it a scientific issue or a matter of the eye? Is it a scientific dispute so that you can come till it was born this day and that minute and this minute? Or is it a matter of the eye? If you see it, you see it. You don't, you don't. It's not about science. Ibn Taymiyyah said, and he brought a guy with him, a young guy whose name was, they called him Mufti something. I don't even remember his name, but Mufti. He said, Ibn Taymiyyah was, I said, brother, do not continue that sentence. Please, because I know where you're going. Don't say it. Don't say it, because people like you can never say anything negative about Ibn Taymiyyah. Even Ibn Taymiyyah today, some people appear on satellite channels which we watch in Amman sometimes. Ibn Taymiyyah this, Ibn Taymiyyah that. He was Shaykh al-Islam, the Shaykh of Islam, who brought back Tawheed and Sunnah to the generation since his time until today. And he brought resurrected knowledge of the Quran and Sunnah to a huge and magnificent extent. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did the same. He went to an area of mostly Bedouins. We explained the status of Tawheed among them. The Sunnah, forget about it. Salah, many of them didn't do it, even in Mecca. Siyam, Allah knows who fasted and who didn't. Zakah wasn't given anymore. He was horrified. He wanted to bring back the Quran and Sunnah. To people who didn't have before him a scientific revolution that resurrected the knowledge of the Quran and Sunnah, he goes to a town called the Dir'iyya, where there was an emir, a local chief, named Muhammad bin Sa'ud, who ruled that area and his family for some time before that, and told him, let's bring back Tawheed and the Quran and Sunnah, and he gave him pledge of allegiance that he's going to support the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And Abdul Wahhab told him, I don't want to be a king or a ruler. Because he had a mission. He wasn't thinking about ruling anything. And they agreed on it. Soon after that, Muhammad ibn Sa'ud himself, who didn't think before the da'wah, but thinking about, you know, how to conduct raids and take taxes from these people and that people, he became a scholar. His son, Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, became even a bigger scholar than his father. And you found there, or you find there, if you read about it, a whole era of knowledge and scholars and students, people migrated from different areas of Arabia to Ad-Dir'iyya, to where the Sheikh was, so they can learn from him, became scholars, students of knowledge. People started to talk about Tawheed. They brought the books of the Imams before, Bukhari, Muslim, and safety was ensured throughout Arabia that people now went to Hajj without fearing for their life to end on the way. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab accepted students who migrated from different areas, accommodated them from his very limited wealth. He had to borrow money actually to do that. When he died, he left a lot of debts, because he took money to take care of these students And then when he did that, he became indebted and he died having debts, rahimahullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us that this Imam, what he did was a resurrection of Islam in its purest form. But when you talk about who started the word Wahhabi and who says the word Wahhabi today and what does that mean, then inshallah ta'ala, let's say a few words about it. Which ummah slanders its own leaders and imams? We know about that such ummah. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, if you ask the Jews who are the best of your ummah, they would say the companions of Musa alayhi salam. If you ask the Christians who are the best of the ummah you ascribe yourself to, they would say the disciples of Isa alayhi salam. If you ask the Shia, the Rafida, who are the worst in your ummah, they would say the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So which ummah literally trashes its own leaders? Which ummah trashes its leaders to the extent that they will call the same generation that brought in the Quran and Sunnah kuffar, and the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as women who committed zina? When you look at this, then you have to understand what's going on. Why was Muhammad ibn Abdulwahab the target of this vicious campaign that continues until today? Because of the very mission that he started. Because the kuffar and deviants of all kinds don't want the ummah of Muhammad to go back to its old ways, which was during the time of her Rasul, its Rasul, and the Sahaba, because then they will win. They will become united and mighty. You see, these days, brothers and sisters, I mean, we have to wake up to something. Many people come today and offer this and that solution for the Ummah. And these solutions that they talk about rarely speak about uniting the Ummah again around Tawheed. Because if you are united around Tawheed, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the aid and support again, as we had before. We lost the support from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because we divided in the religion and much bid'ah and deviation started in the ummah. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, was all what he wanted. Once he wrote, and it was sad what he wrote actually. He said, when we started our mission, we thought from all the states that Muslim states that were around us, the Uthmani Khilafah will rush the fastest to help us and support us. Why? Because all what we wanted is to unite the Ummah again around La Ilaha Illallah. But they gathered forces and armies and tried to attack us time after time after time. Among the issues that people today mention is that, for example, they say Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came to make takfir of the ummah, those who don't agree with him, they're kuffar, they're disbelievers. Of course, you have to remember two terms that are opposite to each other. Salafi and Khawarij ideology. These ideologies, you know, Salafi and Khawarij. The Salafi are those who follow the way of Salaf al-Salih. 2 days ago in Luton, I went to a store and went to buy something for my son. And the storekeeper was asking me, I said, Alhamdulillah, I have some of my books here. I hope they'll benefit. He said, are you Shafi? I said, no. Are you Hanafi? He said, no, I'm Salafi. He got angry. Looked at me like, you're Salafi. The Salaf died long time ago. I said, I'm calling myself Salafi. I'm not the Salaf. Salaf died. I'm not calling myself the Salaf, the ancestors. I'm still here. I didn't die yet. I'm saying Salafi with a ya. Ya is in Arabi, ya al nisbah. You ascribe yourself to someone. Who are the Salaf al-Salih? Is it a dirty word to use? Is it something that you should hide from it when you hear? Does it what invoke what other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Who are the Salaf? Salaf, if you read the books of the Imams, before we were created, born into this earth, the Imams of Bukhari, before him, after him, they used the term called the Salaf al-Salih. And that refers to the first three generations in Islam. The Sahaba, companions, Tabi'een, second generation, Tabi'i Tabi'een, third generation of Islam, led by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So this term, wherever you find it in the books, it's not talking about the people who call themselves Salafi today. These are people who ascribe themselves to those generations. So as Salaf al-Salih are the first three generations in Islam. in a mutawatir hadith, the highest level of authentic ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best people, khayrun nas, the best people, qarni, are my generation, thumma alladhina yalunahum, then the next generation, thumma alladhina yalunahum, then the next generation. So he mentioned three generations. So when I come here today in this life, so many sects and groups and politics and whatever it is, what you want to follow in this life, I want to ascribe myself as a methodology, as a way of understanding, practicing the religion to those three generations. Why? The Sahaba, Allah promised them Jannah in the Quran. So they're safe. They already crossed the bridge. I just want to follow them. Then people start telling you, think you're better than us, you think we're kuffar. The Salaf are the first three generations of Islam. The Salafi is the one who ascribes to the way of the Salaf al-Saleh. So, did the Salaf al-Saleh call each other kuffar? But even when they had dispute with each other, when they fought each other, the Sahaba, did they call each other kuffar? No. The books who go or run through the manhaj or the on the road that was started by Salaf al-Saleh cannot call people who defy them, contradict them, kuffar, unless Allah calls them as such in the Quran and the Sunnah. So you have now those who ascribe themselves to a Salaf being accused of calling everybody else a kafir, ignoring the sect that still causes so much fitna. I'm just trying to choose my words the best way I can. Causes so much fitna by saying, this is what I think Islam is, and everybody else is a kafir. I remember a young man once, when I came, when I went to the States in 1980, a couple of years after that, a young man came from one country where the ruler had just put everybody in jail, because whenever they had a problem with some so-called Islamists, you know, I don't know what that means, Islamists. So they put everybody in jail because they know who's who. So they put some Salafis there, and this guy said, I'm Salafi. I said, okay, what happened in jail? He said, we were 12 different jama'ah when we prayed. 12 different jama'ah. I said, why? He said, that sect and group had this, Islamic party, what had this and that, and then one man. I said, one man was a jama'ah? He said, yeah. He put a chair in the middle of the jail and said, you're all kuffar, I'm not going to pray with you. So the Khawarij are, by definition, rebellious against the Sharia. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab wanted to bring back the way of the Salaf al-Saleh. See, he couldn't have called people who defied him as kuffar unless they committed shirk. For example, somebody who goes and invokes the dead for help. Is this from Tawheed? It can't be. It can't be, brother. It can't be. So when you go and tell this guy, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said this ayat, Quran, and they insist on that. That's shirk. But if you contradict me with regards to the salah, I put my hands here and I tell you about the hadith, this and that and that and that, you know? And you said, well, I'm going to put it this way, okay? I'm not going to call you a kafir because of it, because this is a difference in opinion. In opinion. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was ascribed to As-Salaf al-Saleh by his writings and the people who were contemporary to him, the scholars ever since. But the Khawarij are the ones whom al-Bukhari rahimahullah said, about whom al-Bukhari said this major statement. When he read what the Khawarij did, and they're the ones who, if you disagree with them, you're a kafir. So your blood is halal, your property is halal, your children and family and wife and children, they're halal for them. Imam Bukhari, when he read about their history, the vicious history they had, he said, if it wasn't for the fact that As-Salaf al-Saleh, again, look at that term here, Al-Bukhari, way before Saudi Arabia, so don't think he was paid by the Saudi. Al-Bukhari said, if it wasn't for the fact that As-Salaf al-Saleh did not call the Khawarij kuffar, I would have. He looked at the horrible things they did. So when they say Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came to make takfir of everyone, they say, okay, you're telling a Sunni, you're a Shi'i. He's telling, no, I'm Sunni, now you're a Shi'i. Or a Christian, he tells you, I'm a Christian, you tell him, no, you're a Jew. because these are opposite. Al-Khawarij, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, are the dogs of hellfire, an authentic hadith. You can find it, inshaAllah ta'ala. My website is islamlife.com. Email address islamlife@gmail.com. I can send you text about the Khawarij to make one dizzy. But we have to think first about some other aspects. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, with regards to the Khilafah al-Uthmaniyya, now, he couldn't have made takfir or other people. Takfiris are the opposite of the Salafis. They're opposite, you know? Because these ones, they want to bring back Tawheed. These people are a deviant sect that still exists until today. We have so many problems with them. I hear that you have a bigger problem here in Britain with them. In America, it's a huge country. So they're not connected as they are connected here. Brothers and sisters, be aware of them. And I would sometimes sit with some of them and say, listen, you know there are hadith that are authentic about the Khawarij, the description, you know, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will do to them, that they are the dogs of hellfire, the worst dead people under the cover of the sky. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, if I lived until they come, I'll kill them like Ad was exterminated. And they do this and that. They spare the kuffar, but attack the believers. And they accuse everybody of being a kafir. Yes? Would you put a checklist there on the wall and describe yourself according to the checklist? Because you're a Khawarij. You might be checking all of them, man. Why don't you look at the hadith and think about them? They're about you. They're not about those who call to the way of a Salaf Salah. They're about you. Because you're the one who has no honor for the religion. Those who broke the religion so many times, who kill Muslims and then commit suicide or whatever it is, and you calling people who call to the Sunnah, what? No. I'll tell you one thing before we go to the Ibn Abdul Wahhab and the Uthmani Khilafah. Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, was murdered, as you know, by one of the Khawarij. The night before he killed Ali, that man stood up in Qiyam, reciting Quran and making Salah the entire night. He said, what I'm going to do is the best action I've ever done in Islam. Can you, let me repeat. Ali ibn Abi Talib is who? The cousin of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ali is in Jannah. But this man called him a kafir. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ali, do you know who's the most miserable member of this ummah, my ummah? He said, who, O Rasulullah? He said, the one who hits you here and makes the space from here to here bloody. That's the man who made Qiyam al-Layl by night, thinking he's going to do the best action in Islam. Subhanallah. You see here how these people are twisted? That hadith about the miserable member of the Ummah of Muhammad was about you, who killed Ali ibn Abi Talib. These hadith don't make stir any emotions. You think, brothers, let me use a break now. Let me think about what I'm doing. There is something wrong going on here in my behavior. Let me compare me to the Sahaba and see how they behave. Therefore, I know that if I am on the straight path or not. But what can we say, brothers and sisters? Wallah, you know, this group, the Khawarij, has always caused Muslims and Islam trouble. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, said, it is not known that the Khawarij ever helped the cause of Islam and Muslims in their jihad. And think about it, it's happening also today. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, during his time, we mentioned Arabia. It was divided into many, many, many towns and local chiefs, everybody calling themselves Amir, fighting with each other, violence, they take taxes from each other, attacking each other, Salah, Zakah, forget about them, even in Mecca. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, during that time, lived in an area that was not like NOT under the control of the Uthmani Khilafah for generations before. Just like was the case with India, Pakistan of today, Bangladesh, they were not under the Khilafah or Uthmaniyya, or Yemen, or Oman, or the eastern part of Arabia. The northern part of half of the western part of the Gulf coast, Arabian Gulf Coast, was populated by a tribe called Bani Rashid. Bani Rashid, by the way, they were Rafida. They are the ones who were fighting harshly against Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. They paid some tax to the Khalifa, but he wasn't controlling them. In fact, the Khilafah during the time was very weak, that Muhammad Ali Pasha became the effective ruler of Egypt during that time. So here's Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, goes to a town that was not under the control of the Uthmani Khilafah, did not rebel against any ruler. He went to a ruler and told him, let's have a pact to bring back Tawheed. And the ruler agreed, he said yes. He didn't give up his kingship or Imara to bin Abdul Wahhab. He was a subject, he was under that Amir. Yes, of course he took his advice because he was the scholar, but that was the Amir, the leader. So how did Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab become a rebellious against any state? Which one? I mean, I'm really interested in hearing, because it took me 10 months to research what's in this book, 700 pages, 10 months of my life. And I started by saying, when I find the truth, I'll put it here. Yes, I am a follower of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, not a Wahhabi, but I follow the aqidah he called to and the practices. If he made a mistake, I'm not gonna say it's not a mistake. It is a mistake if he did it. But I didn't find any evidence that he fought against or rebelled against any ruler himself. A young man once sent me something. I hope, brothers, you're patient, inshallah, because there's so much to say. I can't really summarize 700 pages in one glass. And so many things we hear make us want to start with some topic, then another, but too many topics here. One young man told me that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was rebellious, Khawarij. I said, why? He said, because he rebelled against the states that were around Ad-Dir'iyya, which was the seat of Muhammad bin Sa'ud, the Amir of that area. So I said to him, okay, let's talk about Khawarij. Khawarij usually, it means to rebel, when it's talk about the ruler, that you're living in a state, and there is a leader on your state, you're there, you rebel against the state. That's called Khuruj. But if two rulers fight each other, that's not called Khuruj in any way or form. You see what I'm saying? They don't even understand the topic. If you're here in this country, there is a ruler. If you rebel against that ruler, yeah, that's Khuruj. But if he's fighting with somebody else, another ruler, that's not Khuruj. That's fighting. That's whatever it is. It might be jihad, might be fighting for money. And therefore, when they say Ibn Abdul Wahhab did that, where is the evidence? There is no evidence. The Uthmani Khilafah did not control that part of the world for time, since decades before that. Also, he did not attack the Uthmani Khilafah in any way or form. He sent letters to them, calling them to the da'wah, and they rejected it. And then the Uthmani Khilafah, because it was weak, effectively it was only ruling Iraq and the Sham, Syria area of today. Egypt was out of their control, and Africa was nominally under the Khilafah, but they were independent states. So they sent who? Muhammad Ali Pasha to go fight Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Now, he didn't call for that fight because it's not in his interest to fight the Khilafah to begin with. And he didn't want to. He wanted to strengthen the Khilafah. Muhammad Ali Pasha now, let's talk about him a little bit. He is the first one to invite the French Navy into the Red Sea, right across from Mecca and the other Islamic area of Hijaz. You understand what I just said? He was the first to invite the French. He was known for being fascinated by France and wanted to bring French influence into the Arabian area. Allowed them to go through ships close to Mecca, the French. Then he wanted to fight the Wahhabis himself, so-called Wahhabis. So here's Muhammad Ali Pasha, when the army wants to leave. He left actually, crossed the sea to the Hijaz area. Then he heard that the Uthmani Khalifa during his time asked some people in Egypt to overthrow him. You see the joke here? Help us, we can't fight this Khawarij, rebellious Wahhabi, whatever. Okay, I'll help you. This man was under the influence of the French. He took his army, crossed the sea, went to Yanbu' of today, the same port today. Then he heard that the Uthmanis, by the way, just tried to overthrow you, are they? He went back to Egypt. Then he sent his son Ibrahim Pasha to continue the fight. It's a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a hikmah. He defeated the first Saudi state. Now let's talk about Ibrahim Pasha. He's the stepson of Muhammad Ali Pasha. Now years after that, Muhammad Ali Pasha had a dispute with the Khalifa in Istanbul, the Uthmani Khalifa. Because they were weak and he was strong, he sent who to fight the Khilafah and bring it down? Ibrahim Pasha. You see here the connection? It's amazing. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was a British agent. Sadler says to Ibrahim Pasha, thank you very much for destroying them. Also, he left Basra 27 years before the British Council ever arrived at Basra. Also, he helped destroy the Khilafah, but he didn't fight it. He was a rebellious man. He never fought any ruler himself, never revolted against any ruler. But the Khilafah sent Muhammad Ali Pasha, who was under the influence of the British, to come and fight the Wahhabis, so-called Wahhabis. He leaves, they try to overthrow him, he goes back, he sends Ibrahim Pasha, that's the hero who came to fight the Wahhabis on behalf of the Uthmanis. A few years later, he almost brought down the Khilafah. Read the history, brothers. He almost brought it down. Who came to the aid of the Khilafah when Muhammad Ali Pasha had sent his army through Syria all the way to Antakya of today? He had a small navy, the British and the French. They destroyed his navy and told him, you have to go back. They said, you have to go back, and he went back. In return for his going back, they gave him Syria for life. He was the ruler of Syria for life. Put all these things together, brothers, in perspective, so that inshallah we can answer any questions you have. I wanted to come strong here today against some sects and groups for many reasons. First of all, as-salaf al-salih are the best part of this ummah. Anyone who doesn't ascribe himself to them, at least in practice and methodology, is a deviant. There's no doubt about that. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my ummah will divide into 73 groups, all of them in hellfire except one. When they asked him which one, he said, what I and my companions are like today. So when he was in his life, in life, or on this earth, and the Sahaba, they are the best part of the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we want the Muslims to go back to that part. Now, you've seen some Salafis here and there, they were harsh with you, you know, they were not really, you know, but don't worry about that. Worry about yourself here. When you want to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you must think about that stance. Save yourself with Allah and follow the way of the Sahaba. So somebody today, like, you know, okay, you might name Jalal, he's, mashallah, he smiles in one lecture, in another lecture he's shouting, screaming about sects. I don't like him, he's harsh. Oh, but you can't like, dislike Muhammad, can you? Can you dislike Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Can you dislike the Sahaba? So I came out strong against the sects because we've been hearing so many things about them coming and trying to deceive young Muslims. I tell you, brothers, don't allow anyone to deceive you. Think, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a brain just He gave me. And I only have a little bit more time than you to make a research, but every one of you should go back to the resources and ask the scholars of Islam who proved to be on the Sunnah and the books before of the Imams that we know. Then you can distinguish between who's right and who's wrong. But Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was an Imam of the Ummah of Muhammad. He wanted to bring back Tawheed, to fight Shirk, to unite the Ummah of Muhammad again around that message, and to follow the way of the Sahaba. Now, when you talk about him in terms of honor, because what he did is what Ibn Taymiyyah before him tried to do, and those before him. Why he was attacked more? This is a question I asked before in this lecture. Because he actually succeeded in establishing a state that followed Tawheed. That made the people, the sects, like dead with jealousy. How he succeeded. Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah, brought the knowledge of the Sunnah. But he couldn't establish a state because he was not a Khawarij anyway. Because, you know, no ruler offered him what Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was offered. But Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helped him to establish an Islamic state. What's the problem, brothers? You have a problem? Do we have a problem with someone who tells you Allah is one, you can only worship Him? Establish the Salah and the Siyam and the Zakat and the Hajj. You have a problem with that? No, we don't have a problem with that. What do we have a problem with is the kuffar using this term to describe one of your imams. And therefore, you have to be vocal in responding to them. I once remember an old man, older than me, I'm 50 years, at least 60, maybe 65. He was a principal of a school in Connecticut. So we gave away hundreds of books, copies for free. Well, the brothers, you hear about Wahhabis all the time? Read about them now, okay? So he came and looked at the book, then went away. I said, brother, come on, let's go. After I gave a khutbah, I challenged everyone in that khutbah to read before they make any decision or judgment. Just a challenge. You go to school, you read books about chemistry this thick. I did, at least. Don't tell me you can't read a book about Islam so you can learn your religion. Don't make a decision until you hear, read from the authentic resources about this man. I told him, what's going on, brother? He said, all my life I've been hearing things about this man. I said, this is your chance to actually learn about him. So take the chance, take the book for free. He said then that, you know, the name Wahhabi in the media. I said to him, brother, don't allow the kuffar to tell you who's a good Muslim and who's a bad Muslim. Don't allow the kuffar and their media to tell you, this is a bad Muslim. If the kuffar are saying about someone is a bad Muslim, you must think twice. It might be good. You know, after 9/11, many people became Muslim. Some of them said, because of all the negative media about Islam, and we don't trust the media, we thought that there must be something good in that religion. Really? And they studied it, they became Muslim. I said to him, brother, take the book and read it. 700 pages, take a few months. He read it in a few days and came back and said, now I believe he's an imam. This is what I want you to do, brothers, inshallah. Reach out to the resources. Inshallah, soon we'll send copies of this book to here so that bi'idhnillah azza wa jal you can learn more and more about it. But this is the summary I wanted to talk about. Sorry if I missed many of the topics I wanted to talk about, but you know, it's becoming late. I think through the questions and answers, inshallah ta'ala, we can add more information. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.